So I believe they're going to put a polling question up on the screen to start us off, because I don't want to bias your own perceptions of what we're about to say and cue you on. So right now, please text, what is that, 223 on this following poll, which is, which of the following Department of Defense, or which should the DoD do in order to ensure that they are best equipped to face a future adversary?
Nothing.
Awesome. A, reform the acquisition process. B, be a part of the 4% for freedom crowd. C, both. Or D, none of the above. Okay, you can kill it. So it looks like reform wins the day, and that certainly is a topic of discussion. You would think that was the only topic of discussion in the Pentagon right now, is how do we reform the Pentagon? How do we, you know, buy things better, faster, cheaper? How do we innovate? How do we turn DoD into Google? There's, you know, all sorts of goodness there, and yet there is a separate component of the discussion, which is our simple ability to produce platforms or major military platforms. And this discussion is kind of encapsulated two different ways. One, in Secretary Hagel's 2014 rollout of Force of the Future at the Reagan National Defense Forum, where he launched a number, or at least codified a number of initiatives to include the Defense Innovation Unit Experimental, and with really a focus on a soup to nuts reform process inside the Department of Defense that has had a number of results, some good, some that have been squashed or set aside for the time being, and we'll talk about those, the aspects of all of those. The other aspect that I want to talk about is McCain's Restoring American Power report that some of you may have read that came out earlier this year. And in that, he describes the force that we say we want, lots of ships, lots of tanks, lots of men and women in uniform. And yet the report also goes on to say that no matter how much we desire to get to 350 ships in the Navy, in 4 years, we get 59. We say we need 80, and by the way, we need 81. No matter how many men and women we would like in uniform now, the report suggested 50,000 plus. The report also highlighted that we get 8,000 a year before we start getting more Chelsea Mannings and Bo Bergdahls. We are also short, the report underscores, we are short several hundred combat aircraft. So the argument really is multifaceted, both from a reform stance as well as a rebuild stance. So here with me today to talk about these issues are, as Albert already introduced, Raj, Jackie, and Alana. And to kick things off, Raj, so you're in charge of Defense Innovation Unit Experimental, henceforth known as DIUx, and you've been there as part of, what I call the DIUx 2.0, the kind of relaunch of the initial initiative. Tell us, how is this different from past efforts that have been aimed at reforming or enabling the acquisition process, and how are you guys unique amongst the current panoply of initiatives and organizations out there attempting to attack this problem?
Sure, thanks, Stephen. It's a pleasure to be here with everyone. So DIUx, our mission is to access commercial technologies and get them rapidly to our men and women in uniform. You know, there's been, I think, 78 blue ribbon panels on acquisition reform since the McNamara times. Our view at DIUx and our charter is we can't change everything, but we're going to focus and move out on the pieces that we can. So what we do is try to solve our customers' problems. And our customers are the services, the Air Force, the Army, the Navy, the Marine Corps, the combatant commanders. We focus on capability gaps that they have and try to use some of our unique vehicles and access to non-traditional vendors to solve those problems very quickly. So there's kind of three core aspects to the methodology that we've put together. One, it's fast. Two, it's flexible. And three, it's collaborative. And I'll quickly kind of walk through that. So fast. If you're going to work with companies that normally don't do business with the government, you've got to move at the speed of business. So we, since last May, since we started 2.0, as you said, have done 21 OT contracts. The represents about $42 million of capital. The average time from solicitation to contract signing has been 78 days, which I think is still too long. Our goal is to get it below 60, and so we'll get back there. But that's at the speed where a young company can make a decision, do I want to go service JP Morgan, or do I want to solve problems for the Department of Defense? So the speed part is critical. Flexible is the other part. So from IP rights to requiring two sets of books or not requiring two sets of books, the type of contract, we kind of cut through the things that a young company, again, can't solve or handle. And then finally, collaborative, right? I think one of the biggest things, my observation coming back into government, is the separation between the operator and user and the person that's going to go buy or build that, right? So the operator says, hey, I have this need. It goes through some requirement process, sent somewhere else, and then 5 years later, you get it, right? And that makes sense for certain types of products that we're going to have very long life. But if you're buying software, if the half-life of that software is shorter than the time it takes to buy it, you'll never catch up. So collaborative. We take us, we take the customer, and we take the vendor, and we literally sit around a table and negotiate what's going to be built, what's the milestone payments, how do we get what we need for the government. And you know, as software goes, it we can be flexible and continue to iterate. So those are some of the things that we do, and I'll highlight and I'll preface that everything that I've described, we have no unique authorities or powers at DIUx. These are things that are available through the entire department, and we're just the first ones pioneering it.
That's great. So a lot of times, when it comes to DoD engagement with the private sector, and by private sector I'm referring to companies and individuals outside the conventional defense industrial base, there's a sense that either the private sector or DoD can or should do more to enable their business or their capability, kind of like what you were talking about, Raj, enable the company to even get to the position, the starting line, to engage the Pentagon, right? The assumption, I think, sometimes is that all companies are at that starting line already, right? Some may still be in the locker room, like putting on their game uniform. Jackie, a lot of the work that you've done with Hacking for Defense and other initiatives appears to kind of get at this. We have other people in the room, like Christopher Zember, who've been involved with this as well. How do you kind of view private sector engagement with DoD, and more importantly, what can DoD do to better enable that private sector engagement?
Yeah, I think that's a great question. And typically when that question is asked, you get the same response that we got in the poll today, which is it's acquisition reform. And you know, while I think that acquisition reform is absolutely needed, there's plenty of FAR exceptions and commercially friendly contract vehicles. You've got DIUx, you've got other rapid prototyping places that use flexible contracting methods. So to me, especially because we've staked our business on this in the last 3 years, we opened up in Silicon Valley with the purpose of being able to enable this engagement between government and the private sector. DIUx is one of our clients, and we work across the DoD as well and the IC. But what I really see as a problem in terms of what's happening, and not at DIUx, I think DIUx has this right, but what I see in other places when they start doing this engagement is that it's a lack of agency on the government's part. So a government person, say a program manager, will start talking to a private company. They'll start tech scouting. And that private company then gets a signal that this person has the agency to make the decisions that need to be made for the deal to get done, you know, or for some contract to be put in place. And they're going through the process, and this company is told, okay, you're going to have a contract in place at this time for this type of work. And that time comes, and then it slips 12 months, or it slips 15 months. And I say this because it's actually happened to us now several times, and I've seen it happen at many other companies. And the most frustrating aspect of that to a private company is that what it shows on the government's behalf is that they didn't do their homework correctly. They didn't account for the realities of their own system. Oftentimes, program managers or whoever's doing this tech scouting doesn't understand how money moves within their own organizations. And that is probably one of the most frustrating aspects of this interaction. It's something that I think DIUx gets right very well, and what Raj just talked about, and how they plan all this out before they go and actually start engaging with this private company. And so it's not necessary. It's not about, okay, we need to go do more policy. It's about how are we changing and empowering the people within the system to adopt this non-stovepiping mentality. When I was an engineer in the Air Force, I got very good at contracts. And people in my company think that I'm some kind of contracting expert, and that I must have been a contracts officer when I was in the military. But I just understood contracts because I had to get things through the system. And I think we need to be encouraging people inside the government to adopt more of this mentality.
Great. So, Alana, used to be a DASD for MIB, or sorry, Deputy Assistant Secretary of Defense for Manufacturing and Industrial Based Policy. There's a saying in the military that the enemy gets a vote. Well, so does the industrial base and the building itself. From your perspective, on a policy level, you know, how do folks like Steve Welby, who's here, he's former ASD R&E, how do folks like him and you and your previous job, how do you guys create and craft good policy? How should the current administration craft good policy that enables both the defense reform initiatives, you know, enterprises like Raj's, as well as these prototypes throughout their life cycle into hopefully the really good ones into a program of record or an MDAP?
Yeah, no, thank you for that question. And a quick shout out, because Steve Welby was indeed an amazing colleague. And Raj is doing some great things, and is indeed piloting the way DoD should do its work, but he has not invented anything that wasn't there before. There are an enormous amount of exceptions. There are two different systems for purchasing. There's even been a piloted authority to keep a little bit of the extra savings that you might have. So things have, as Raj had said, there have been a ton of studies and laws on the books, and the last couple of NDAAs have put more laws on the books that are now making themselves felt in a new commercial purchasing handbook, which will be done sometime this summer, which is the way you can, the Pentagon can purchase using the commercial rules instead of the military rules, which are much simpler. All that is good. I continue to be concerned, though, that that won't be enough, and I'll put it down to three simple things, which is leadership, culture, and incentives. Because all of that has been there for such a long time, but what I've seen, when I've seen it work, I've seen those three assets being brought to bear. So, Special Operations Command has a reputation for being able to do procurement really, really well. I think that that's partly because they've got great leadership. I think that's partly because they have a great reputation for warfighting that lets them take risks like other people don't take risks. So we need to help our procurement core take risks. We need to put in the right incentives. Right now, when you're a contracting officer and you're somewhere around a GS-13 or a GS-10, which is sort of a early to medium stage career person, everything is a disincentive. You make one mistake, the IG's on you. You didn't save a penny, that's a problem in your personnel file. But when you create savings, when you get something out to the field quickly, that doesn't show itself in your personnel file as easily. And it's something Eric Schmidt started to allude to a little bit in his earlier conversation. So we need to rethink some of those incentives to give people that cover. I mean, people have to do a good job. They can't be corrupt. They have to be smart. But they need the incentives to do the right things and to be risk takers. DIUx was set up to be a risk taker, but we can't just do this around the edges. As much good as Raj has done, it is pennies compared to the budget that DoD spends all the time. And that's not at all a hit on you. It's just you've got a universe to play with that is showing the way. But guess what? The whole building and all the buildings around the country can take that way as well. So the right incentives, and the incentives are not just around personnel, it's also about the flow of money. Again, I think Eric was talking about it earlier that, you know, savings disappear. Well, Congress actually provided a tiny little pilot authority a couple years ago that would allow you to maintain some of the savings, and it's a long story as to why that didn't continue to evolve, but there's a precedent. And so that's sort of on Congress to think about extending authority for some of the funds that people may have when they're able to save or be able to transfer between programs in an easier methodology than you have now when you have to go through all of these offices and finally get your whole package together, make sure that somebody didn't trade away your part of the package, and then it goes to Congress, and then there's another set of briefings and debates. I'm not saying no to oversight at all as a former congressional staffer. I am saying sometimes that means that it's a 12-month or a 24-month program. And then the other thing about, you know, I don't know if you want to put it in, I guess, in culture. You have a lot of really, really dedicated people and a lot of really smart people, but a lot of them have spent their entire life in government. And that means you're not necessarily as nimble as the private sector when you're trying to negotiate, especially with the non-DIB, the commercial base, and especially the Silicon Valley, the Brooklyn Navy Yard to like harken to New York, or even Wichita, Kansas with you know, some innovative planes that the Textron had put out at no taxpayer expense. So I saw when I was there a pretty modest sized fellowship I think was created in the mid 90s, and it's a Secretary of Defense's fellows, and they get to go spend, I believe it's just a year or two out in the private sector, cybersecurity at a bank or contracting for one of the defense contractors. They come back and they you know, we all know what it's like to experience as opposed to hear in a lecture. They've experienced what it's like to do business a little differently. And then their follow-on assignments have nothing to do, at least that was my experience, have nothing to do with what they just did. And so all that knowledge dissipates. We should be doing this for a lot more people. I would love to see it for the entire procurement corps somewhere in the course of their career. And I'd love to see them have to go back. It's sort of like a payback when you get a scholarship to college, you have to stay with the company for a couple of years. I'd love to see them stay and then use that investment in their fellowship to bring about a different culture in the procurement corps. So that would be my prescription.
So let me turn this on its head. Raj, from your perspective, I mean, in my opinion, I think you guys have had pretty solid early success since last year. And I guess my question to you, following on Alana's comments, what can you attribute that early success to? And then more importantly, how do you scale or grow those early wins into you know, Alana's domain, right? Where you start to chalk up programs of record, and then they grow on the, you know, 30-year sustainment cycles.
Yep. No, great questions, and I agree with a lot of what Alana said, and particularly around, you know, so you asked what made us successful. I think it's those things that you highlighted, right? We had senior level leaders in the Pentagon that supported us and candidly protected us from some of the folks more resistant to change. We were allowed to fail and experiment and try things differently. But more importantly, how do we scale, right? Because we are a rounding error of a rounding error as if you look at the defense budget. I kind of view, you know, DIUx's mission is to do agile culture change, right? So if you're going to write a big piece of software, right? So if I use a software analogy, you don't go and write all of a massive program over 5 years and then release it. You build little pieces of it, and you take it out, and you test it, and some things work, some things don't work. You fix bugs, and you get this continual feedback that a few years in, you have a great leading software package. I feel that's our mission at DIUx, to do culture change. Right? We are never going to be the acquisition arm of the department. We're not the R&D arm of the department. We have existing structures to do that. I think our job is to try new things, and on a low-cost basis, the things that work, we can scale. The things that don't work, it was a great experiment, it didn't work, we can, at a very, you know, without wasting a lot of time and money, remove it. So, you know, what kind of changes do I mean by that? So incentives, right? Incentives for agility, right? So we, the way we structure our team, we track how long these things take, and we incentivize folks that are able to move it through the system faster. You know, what of those can now be scaled? The entire OT system is, again, not exclusive to us. So we wrote a guide on the website. Anybody can go and download it on how do you do a commercial style OT. And there are now other established groups, procurement officers and groups within the department that are starting to do this, which is great. Mm. And then, you know, there's finally, you know, if I think about the technologies that will be very important on the battlefield of the future, things like autonomy, things like artificial intelligence. Some of the best engineers and best minds working on those are working in commercial companies that have their own markets, right? If they can better recommend a product on their website and they get a 1% growth, they will be hugely rewarded. But those same technologies have applicability to the defense world. And, you know, we, the department has traditionally been a monopsony buyer, right?
Yep.
But now these, we're a competitive buyer. And so we have to change our culture and process to achieve it. So, you know, so long term, we experiment with things. The things that work scale. You know, if in an ideal world, I'm nervous to put a timeline on it, but you don't need a DIUX anymore, right? Because those things have been adopted, and then we move on.
So Jackie, hacking for defense and the enterprise around that and the people who support it, it's always appeared to me to be more of a movement than a particular, you know, program or a class you go through at Georgetown or Stanford or whatever. Piggybacking off some of the previous comments, how do you take that culture and the people who kind of self-select for a program like that, you know, especially from the military side, how do you take that and grow that, whether virally or through mandate or fiat? How do you grow that across the Pentagon, or is it something that should grow across Pentagon instead of just being in a petri dish?
Yeah, I mean, there's two versions of hacking for defense. For people that don't know what it is, there is a Hacking for Defense course that we taught last year at Stanford University, where we basically took national security problems, brought them through Stanford, and applied the lean startup methodology and how basically the science of innovation back to those problems, just to see what would happen. And it turned out it was a successful course. There was a group that came out of it that got venture capital funding. A number of the teams went on to get continued government funding. And now there's been other universities that have adopted this course, including Georgetown. And part of the rationale behind this is that the culture thing goes both ways, right? It's inside the government. Yes, there needs to be a culture change, and we all recognize that. But there's such a divide between government now and this new generation, you know, the millennials, in terms of there's just no connection there unless they actually go and enlist in the military, or they go and become a government civilian. And so this is one way that we saw to provide students an opportunity to participate in national security issues using their classroom knowledge of entrepreneurship. On the other side of it, through my company, we provide Hacking for Defense for our government clients. And our rationale behind this is that there's a lot of talk about innovation, and being in Silicon Valley, what we've seen as the most interesting aspect to this is that nobody goes out and says, we're gonna be innovative. They do it by what they do, right? Whatever it is they're building. But through that process, there's definitely a framework, a science behind innovation. And so we have wanted to take those same principles and basically bring them back inside the system that we think that needs it most. And so through that, we've taken the lean startup methodology, which basically encourages people when they're looking to develop something, just like the entrepreneur, to be able to identify very early on the value proposition, your key partners, come up with hypotheses around what it is that you want to build, do iterative testing, and really understand the feasibility and the desirability of what it is that you're building for your users. And this is coming off the problem before that, coming from acquisitions myself, we built a lot of things for a lot of money that didn't solve anybody's problems. And so we're hoping that through this process, this will impact culture and how we look to putting our dollars, our taxpayer dollars, to the things that we're building.
Great. So, Alana, quickly, and then we'll go to Q&A. A lot of innovation, in fact, increasingly so, at least to the extent we're aware of it, happens outside the United States. MIBP certainly has a role to play in the CFIUS, or foreign investment process, review process. What are your thoughts in terms of engaging compelling foreign technology, but at the same time protecting our own IP and our own kind of supply chains as we try to be more, you know, innovative?
Yeah, no, that's an excellent question. I would actually add to it, and it's the CFIUS, it's the internal investment from overseas, but also export controls and how do we protect what we've invented. So my predecessor used to say, all the best stuff used to be invented here, but that is just no longer true. And so that creates a dilemma for DOD. One is that we want to probably buy some things that are not invented here, and we can, but not we anymore, but DOD can, but it just has to go through a process where it has to get through the Defense Security Service, particularly if it needs clearances for facilities, clearances for personnel, which can be more cumbersome depending on the nation from which this company is coming. We also have the issue that there are some amazing things being done by U.S. companies, but with two problems. One is DOD is no longer the largest buyer, so they, if they're going to sell to DOD, they run the risk of being prevented because they're in a classified setting, for example, from then exporting that. And there's also the broader risk of export controls stymieing their growth. And often, even some fairly modest-sized companies are using engineers from abroad, or they have their manufacturing abroad, and so that creates all kinds of classification and export control issues. And that is something DOD, I think, has to really grapple with. It's not a DOD-only issue. Mm. The State Department has a huge role to play, the Commerce Department. The Obama administration actually did a great deal in terms of updating the export control rules, but things move so quickly that certainly around software and hardware and certain types of, you know, like infrared or certain other types of very specified technologies, I think those export control rules have to be constantly updated because there is so much happening overseas that either we're going to want to buy or we're going to not want to prevent our companies from selling abroad because they're no longer so far ahead of the curve that it makes sense to stymie their commercial development. But back to CFIUS really quickly, it's also very interesting as an issue because you know, I was in those CFIUS conversations and case decisions, which I can't talk about here. But what I will say is they were becoming more and more complex. People think about it in terms of, oh, you're buying that wind farm next to a particular installation in Nevada, which is all public knowledge. It's all, you know, in the front pages.
Don't forget about Smithfield.
The journal.
Yeah, that was a big deal.
Or Smithfield, you know. But there are more and more complex kinds of cases where there are all kinds of relationships between the various stakeholders and investors, and how much say do they really have, and how much insight will they really have, and what are they buying? Will that technology that they might be buying impact so many different systems that are in our critical infrastructure, in possibly a DOD-needed hardware, et cetera? And it's very, very hard to draw all those pieces, and you can't just shut off all investment. So it's becoming a much more complicated set of problems. I don't envy the people around that table now.
Boy, wouldn't it be great if we had a graphic user interface that depicted our entire industrial-based supply chain? Imagine that. So we've got a couple minutes left for questions. So if you have a question, please raise your hand. Wait for the mic to come to you. Tell us who you are, and please actually ask a question. Right there in the back.
Liam Collins from the Modern War Institute at West Point. Alana, I'd agree with you that Special Operations Forces have been uniquely successful, and primarily because of the leadership and culture. But do they also have authorities? I mean, this isn't a question, it's leading into it, but do they have authorities that allow them to, short circuit the process? And if that's the case, can the military, the larger military, make the changes to the innovation or the acquisition process that it needs to? Or does it require some kind of major legislative change? If you look probably in the last 75 years, probably the most significant changes from the military weren't some kind of new technology, but more of the legislative changes of the National Security Act in 1947 and Goldwater-Nichols in 1986. So do we need some kind of major legislative change, or is it something the military can do on its own in order to kind of reform this acquisition process and move beyond a 1960s PPBS system?
I'm a big believer in understanding what you need to fill once you start doing it, and there are so many authorities that are already on the books. I'd say there's a lot that can happen before you go to Congress, and then you can look for much more modest slivers of changes. Then you can explain better to Congress when you actually show specifically what you need. I don't know, Faraj, if you have a different.
Yeah, there's tons of authorities, recent from the 16 NDA, from the 17 NDA, that apply tons of flexibility, and not just outside the FAR and the OT world, but also within the FAR, having now spent a lot of time actually reading it. There's actually quite a lot of flexibility. It's getting the cultures and the incentives right to empower contracting officers to feel like they can do that.
Can I say one thing? If you're sort of looking at this and researching this, you might want to take a look at what Cybercom is doing. Because Cybercom had only recently gained some acquisition authority, and they were going to SOCOM to get their sort of advice around how to do things. So it's an interesting experiment right now.
Okay, right there up front.
Colin Clark, Breaking Defense. Ilana, and this is directed at all three of you, I think, raised the issue of incentives. But you also have the training and the length of time that an acquisitions officer actually spends in a program. The services run those for the most part. How do you get across the board change for that workforce when each service has the authority to keep fiddling as it wishes?
No, Colin, you're totally correct, if I understand you correctly, because for the long programs of record, for example, clearly requirements continue to be changed, and that's partly what drives the cost and what makes it so difficult for companies who have huge gaps in their production. That is partly what ATNL, I think, was meant to fix. Obviously, it didn't get all the way there, and now there's a question of, is there an ATNL in the future? But that's definitely, internal reform that needs to happen as well. And perhaps we can look at incentives for that kind of internal reform, and whether a disincentive could be created when you continue to fiddle and you have to wait for the 95% solution, but you wait for another 5 years, or you take the 80% solution, you get it out to men and women, in the field today. One other thing, the labs are an amazing resource. The labs know more or less what's going on. They're a great way to just put a check on, hey, does something already exist? Do we really need to reinvent this? Or can we take something that exists and maybe slap on some classified equipment or something that hasn't existed yet, but not invent the entire thing?
One of the things I've noticed working across contracts organizations is that the ones that are reimbursable, meaning that, and I think it's, I think GSA does this, there's other organizations that do this, but basically their salaries are actually tied to how many contracts were let through their shop, versus a case where, if you did one or if you did 50, you're gonna get paid the same exact amount of money. And I do think that there is a model that for support organizations in the government, there can be some of that, I think, incentives put in place in terms of your salary is actually tied to how much you put through the system.
I guess in the last 30 seconds, the thing I would say is it's difficult to take a one-size-fits-all approach to this and incentives. So we have processes that I would say arguably work well for buying large programs. So the way we buy an aircraft carrier, should use one set of processes that are more deliberative and requirements-based. If we're going to try to build a UI system for data, you know, that changes so rapidly that we need an alternative set of incentives and approaches.
And try not to use cost plus.
Yeah.
Small programs, yeah.
Yeah, and by the way, the next session will be how to do all this in a classified setting. So don't hold your breath. Thank you very much. Please join me in thanking our panelists today.